So I spent quite some time to make this book, to translate this interactive thing back to a kind of book format. And I really enjoyed it a lot. I really felt like coming home. I thought this is what I want to do for the rest of my life.
Hi there, everybody. This is Mario. Welcome to another episode of Design Interview 10 Questions, where we interview designers and design experts from all around the world. Today's guest is Joost Grootens, graphic designer from the Netherlands and founder of Studio Joost Grootens in Amsterdam. So welcome, Joost. Thanks for being here.
Thank you. Thank you. Nice being here.
So if you don't mind, I would start with the initial question, which is, what made you become a designer?
Okay, well, we have a long time to talk. So it was for me not clear, immediately clear that I wanted to become a kind of designer. I first thought I was a painter in my teens. I was really a serious painter. And then I went to art school, Rietveld Academy. And within a week, I noticed I'm not an artist. I'm a designer. All the time, I designed my paintings more or less. I was working. I had a very, very different kind of attitude, and kind of to the work I made than my fellow students. And then I was kind of a bit lost. And then I decided to study architectural design because I really liked the content a lot. I really like architecture, thinking about space, thinking about cities. And so I studied architectural design, and I really liked that. And then and it took me some years after my studies to really come to the kind of graphic design part. You also want me to talk about that part, kind of how I moved on from architecture to... So I graduated in the mid-90s and that was probably the best moment in time to graduate as a kind of architect anywhere in the Netherlands, because it was really kind of a lot of things were happening in architecture. What was also happening in architecture, or what was happening in design in general, was kind of the digitization of the tools that we work with. So, and in my final year of my graduation year, I discovered multimedia, interactive media, Macromedia Director, and those kind of softwares. And I was really really interested in that. So I had to do two graduation projects, and one of them became an architectural project, and the other one became this multimedia thing. So for a few years after my kind of graduation, I had two practices. I had one focused on architecture, so I'd say. So it was based on doing interiors, public spaces. I was working with other architects, architecture studios, and I had this kind of multimedia thing where I did in interactive installations or CD-ROMs or those kind of things. And then after a few years, 1998, I had made a kind of interactive installation for an architect in London. It was kind of shown in New York, and we really liked what we made, and we went to a publisher and said, well, we have this thing here. Can you publish it? The publisher said, I'm not going to publish a CD-ROM. I'm not going to do that. Can't you make a book around it? So there's a book as a kind of packaging for that kind of interactive thing. So I spent quite some time to make this book, to translate this interactive thing back to a kind of book format. And I really enjoyed it a lot. I really felt like coming home. I thought, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. And I started to learn and to teach myself graphic design. A lot of things that I'd have done that happened before fell into place, because I, from a very early age, I was kind of collecting books, and I was kind of, so I had a lot of books around me always, and now all of a sudden I could make them. I could thinking about making them. So I start to pick out books that I liked, scan them, try to make the pages, try to learn from the design. Why are there, is the line spacing like this? Why is this, what, why does this composition works better than on the, in this book? So by closely studying the works of others, I started to learn it myself. And then a few years later, but this was on my side project next to my, and I still was kind of continuing my architectural practice. But then a few years later, I was asked to make a book for someone else. And it was interesting, this kind of multimedia thing, what's happening. In those early days, everyone who had a computer was trying it. So it were architects, it were artists, it were kind of designers. So it was not kind of situated in a certain field. So and the people who asked me thought I was a graphic designer. And they asked me if I could do the book. I said, yeah, I can do that, I will. So that's one advice I would give to students. Always say yes to questions that you might not be able to answer. You will find out how to do that later on. And then I met 010 Publishers, which is kind of a publishing house specialized in architecture books. And it was really a kind of good connection. And then I started becoming a full-time bookmaker, a designer of books. And then it took me still some years to call myself actually a graphic designer, because I really felt like a charlatan in those early days, someone who was doing it without being properly trained for it.
You design books, but like especially atlases, and
we design books. We do all sorts of books. And the atlases that we've designed are especially, we're well known for the atlases, but it's not necessary that we only do atlases. We've done, let's say, 200 plus books by now. And of those 200, maybe 10, 15 or so are atlases. So it's really it's not the kind of the main thing. And luckily it isn't, because it's really, making an atlas takes so much time, and it's such a, it's economic suicide to only do atlases, yeah.
But design for you is arrangement of information in an understandable way?
Yes, creating an information system, trying to instrumentalize, to try to make an information tool, to try to put information together, visuals, text, drawings, cartography, and to align them, to make them, to create a kind of balance of those kind of things on the page, so that they become, that becomes a kind of tool, becomes a tool to empower the reader to find things out, to discover things. It's a knowledge tool, the book. And that's how, and that's that kind of, in that sense, the atlas has been an important kind of model for me to look at. Because what I like about the atlas is that it's primarily a visual kind of medium. It's about using all the graphic means possible. There's kind of maps, there are kind of information graphics, there's photography, and there those are kind of become. They are kind of aligned to each other. They are kind of they use one to understand the other. An atlas is kind of a book. It's very dense. It's complex content. It's visual, and it's a non-linear kind of book. Right? So it's you browse through it. You go from one page to, you go to the next, and you can have several points of entry to the book. And in that sense, that's how I approach all the books that I make. So in that sense, although we only did, like, say, 10 to 15 proper atlases that also have atlas in the title, the majority of the books that we make are, in the other sense, atlases, that they kind of, they're kind of approach as a kind of, as a tool, as an information tool.
But is that design for you in general?
Well, not design in general. I'm now talking about the niche that I'm in. So I'm in the I'm very much interested in. Now maybe I should say it differently. I design to understand the world around me. So that's why I designed it. For me, design is a way of finding things out, and I use. So I'm especially interested in the. In the role that design can play in opening up content to create information, to organize data and to make it into information.
And is that what do you try always to create as a designer with your projects?
Yes, I think what we do different kind of things, but I would say the majority of what we do is really try to create tools for the reader to understand the world around them, right, where they live in.
And in the process of making a book, designing a book, is there a specific part of it that you are really interested into?
Well, no, there's not one specific part, because I think everything is related. So I don't see the design as a kind of linear process of stages where you say, okay, first it's about understanding, it's formulating a concept, creating the design and then making it, and then producing it and distributing it. I think for me, they are all interrelated. They're all parallel tracks. So I jump constantly between conceptual thinking to thinking about what colors to use or what typeface to choose, and it's about thinking about the paper and the weight of the object, to it's about doing about research into typologies of books, or thinking about what kind of reader is is interested in this kind of content and how can I approach her. That's kind of. So there's not one specific phase. I think I'm interested in the whole process from the first phone call until the reader accessing the book, working with the book. So even beyond when the book is kind of out of our studio. I'm interested in the whole package.
And do you think perfection exists in design?
Well, if it does, I never had it. So I think as soon as the book comes back from the printer, the first thing we do is to look for the mistake. So it's kind of there's always a mistake there, and it frustrates the hell out of you that you've been working for months, years sometimes, and you've not seen it. And when you open it, when it comes from the printer, the first thing you see is this very obvious thing that you didn't use the right typesetting, or it's kind of this, or it's a typo, or it's a kind of mistake, conceptual mistake. I don't think that. Although I can imagine that when people see some of the work that we make, that they say, "Okay, you must be kind of completely obsessive about what you do," and we strive for perfection. Yeah, of course, we try to make the best thing possible. We spend other people's money. We make an object. We're going to waste paper and ink and effort of people to print and bind it and to transport it to a bookshop. So we try to make the best of that opportunity. But is that perfection? Maybe.
What do you think about the contemporary design scene?
The contemporary design scene. I think the contemporary design scene is very, what can I say about it? I think it's very obsessed with itself. So I think it's a lot about designers looking at other designers. And there's many books of designers made for other designers. I'm also part of that. I'm also interested in what certain kind of designers do, because we're kind of connected nowadays, and because the world has become maybe not for this past few weeks, but in general, the world has become more kind of connected and more we can follow what other people are doing all around the world. We meet each other more often because we can very easily travel, or we see each other in conferences or lectures or in schools. What I find a pity or maybe even stronger, and I find a bit stupid, is that we, because we are kind of so connected, we become very much focused on the here and now, on what's kind of happening right now in design, and how far we can go back in our kind of Instagram feed is kind of what is kind of design. And I feel that I'm personally very interested in also what happened 20 years ago, 40 years ago, 60 years ago in design. Then again, I'm very much involved in education, design education. I'm head of a master. I teach in various schools. I like talking to designers. It's especially young designers, because designers in general, I would say, are kind of optimistic people. They think that they can add something to the world. I think that's kind of optimistic or maybe naive, you could call it. But it's I'd like to talk to optimistic people and to kind of really trying to develop new things. And one of the reasons that I teach is that every the conversations I have and the questions that they kind of provoke by that kind of their work, you're also asking to yourself. So teaching is actually it's another way of self-therapy. So if I ask a question to a student, you actually ask it to yourself. Ask well. I like designers as a species, so to say. But I think that the design and the design field itself is too obsessed with designers. So if you understand what I mean.
But do you think it's something that is happening especially today?
I know what's happening today because I'm part of it. So I don't know really what happened 30 years ago. Probably it's of all the time because we've always been kind of watching each other. So that kind of as a kind of profession, you're kind of as soon as they can become a kind of an awareness, a professional awareness that you call yourself a certain name. So if you call yourself a kind of graphic designer, at one point in the history of graphic design or the history of design, people started calling themselves designer. And as soon as you give yourself that label, you're very likely to look at other people who call themselves like that. And the fact that we have now a much easier kind of access to see what's happening doesn't change that and doesn't make it kind of more that kind of natural interest bigger than in previous days.
You started to study and also to design in a previous generation where internet was not so central in our mm-hmm. daily. And what do you think about the impact the internet had on design?
Well, you're right. When I started studying, there was no such a thing as a kind of internet. I think I opened my first email account maybe in the last year of my studies. But we had books and we had magazines and we had lectures and we had bookshops and we had exhibitions. So there were other things to know about what's happening in the field. What do I think of the internet? I think it's a great tool. Of course, I use it on a daily basis. I have just made a decision, or it's my inability to make books. Maybe it's my inability to not make to heavily engage with kind of the digital. But I think that I understand the book as a format, and that's why I've chosen to work in it as a kind of main medium.
And without internet, do you think you would have reached the same results in your atlases? Or internet was like a fundamental part to get information and data, etc.?
No, I think the results that I got in the atlases had nothing to do with the things that I found on the internet. What you maybe can see in the background of me is kind of is a collection of books that I have, and especially that shelf here. So if I just see it right, this is one full of atlases that I collected and I bought, and mostly very cheap. And I learned a lot from looking at other atlases. It's for me always the starting point project. If I asked to do a kind of a book type that I've never thought of before, then or never worked on before, and then I start to collect books. If I do a collection book for a museum, I start to collect other collection books. If I do a dictionary, I'm going to obsessively look at. I go to libraries, I go to bookstores. I want to hold a thing and trying to understand what it is, and that's the same with the atlases. And of course, I found things on the internet and that I use. But I think it's more what I try to. But the thing is, but if you make books like I do, then you always feel that you have to kind of defend the choice to go to use a kind of what some see as a kind of outdated medium. Huh? And one of the things that I try to incorporate in my designs is how people deal with information, how they access information, the visual conventions of organizing information, and many of those kind of experiences, information experiences, are kind of fed by experiences people have on the internet. So the way how we scroll horizontally, vertically, the way that we through Google image search have a kind of understanding of large quantities of images. Those kind of experiences I try to incorporate in my book designs next to experiences from older books from 100 years ago that I want to learn from. Yeah.
You mentioned before that you are the head of the master in Eindhoven and also teacher in other schools. So how do you see the design education today?
How do I see design education today? I like design schools a lot, and that's why I said earlier that I think designers are nice people. That's maybe that's a very maybe corny remark, but that's it. Design education, design is kind of in an interesting phase right now, where it is kind of it's reinventing itself constantly, of course, but now even more than before, and maybe in a quicker kind of tempo, because so much is happening. The kind of digitization of kind of the tools of design have opened up the field, have given the designer a different kind of role in the whole process, but also have given other people access to that kind of tools. So it's no longer a kind of this mystic kind of exclusive activity. It's kind of open to all. And if that's the case, then what should you teach designers? And that's kind of interesting, because you have the designer or she who does design is no longer limited to the people who kind of study design, or the people who exclusively have a kind of professional practice in design. So if that's the case, then I think that the design education and the designers of the future, they have to adjust that kind of role, and they have to kind of reinvent that role. And that's what I really I'm interested in, kind of. So it's happening in the schools right now, that they're kind of there. You see that the students are trying to reformulate what design is and what the role of the designer can be. And I'm in a school, the Design Academy Eindhoven, which is very much, that's kind of its motto. Right? It's about reinventing design. It's pushing design to the next, to the next iteration of what design is.
And you just said that they are looking for what is going to be the designer afterwards, in the future. And what do you think about that? Where is going to be the designer in the future?
I think that the designer will kind of different roles will take, and one of them would be, it will be a kind of shift from the creator of graphic objects to maybe the creator of the tools to create graphic objects. So maybe the designer is someone who makes the tools for other people to design. I can also imagine that designers will reflect on this kind of shifting position of design, what design is, the role of amateurs, of big tech companies, and what kind of their influence is on the design field. I can imagine that the designers will reflect on that. You at the same time see that kind of designers are taking on more complex topics. So they are kind of involved as kind of specialists in different processes. So they're kind of the creation of news, for instance, of the production of news. I can imagine that kind of that there's a kind of role for designers to play there as translators show different things, like through information visualizations, or to invent new tools for journalism, to invent new practices of journalism. So and that's only one. So and because designers are kind of optimists, they see opportunities and they see chances. I see that design will even diversify much more than it already does, and maybe to a point that it kind of dissolves, being called design. Eh? Maybe it becomes just part of everything.
But do you think the designer will be also more independent in the future?
If you mean by independent, that it's kind of more individual, or yeah. Then I don't think so. I think for a designer to play a kind of meaningful role, she has to engage with others. She has to have kind of collaborations or practices with several kind of different kind of professions or roles present. She has to engage with the user. I think that's the only way forward for design.
We arrived to the last question, which is, in this moment, we are facing this really bad situation with this global pandemic, but do you think the designer can do something? The design world can help in some way? Of course, not medically, but maybe in other.
Yeah. Can we help? Yeah. We are kind of forced to now to use different kind of tools, platforms to exchange our kind of conversations, so we are kind of talking to each other now through a computer platform. These kind of, I think it's one of the tasks that designers could do, or could play, the role they could play is just to, there's all sorts of things that are kind of, that are wrong or happening with these kind of tools. They are kind of force us to think in a certain way. They kind of force us to look in a certain way. So that's kind of the resolution and the kind of the scope of the video camera, the webcam that kind of is now recording both of us. We are kind of reduced to a kind of landscape image, although it's kind of it's a portrait that we're kind of doing, of liquid crystals. There's certain kind of sound quality that's kind of not optimum. So there's kind of this communication process is a new kind of form of communication. So I think designers could highlight kind of the or ridicule, make it more make fun of the kind of the awkwardness of this kind of new way of communication. Another thing that kind of think designers could do is to reinvent this kind of tools, create new a new etiquette, a new kind of way to behave using this kind of tools. That's kind of very much connected to kind of the communication. But I also see a kind of role for designers to play is to make available, to filter the information that's out there, and to really to make sense, to filter the sense from the nonsense. There's so many kind of things kind of said, and by representing the information in a different way, maybe representing also our spaces and our public spaces and our future public spaces in a different way, we could designers can question, and they can question the new conventions that are kind of taking shape right now.
Well, thank you very much, Joost, for your time.
Yeah. Thank you. Well done. Yeah, welcome.